This is the Joe Gaither Show on BamaCentral.com.
Good afternoon, Tuscaloosa. Happy Labor Day. Internet world. West Alabama, how are we doing today? It's the Joe Gaither Show. We're right here on Bama Central and BamaCentral.com. I am Joe Gaither. You're watching us on the Bama Central YouTube channel. You're checking us out on my own social media machines at Joe Gaither 6. You're looking at us on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube right there. Or you are listening to us on the Joe Gaither Show on Bama Central on Spotify, Apple Podcast, or Amazon, your favorite podcast platform. We appreciate everybody who is jumping in and joining us. You can be a part of the program. We're going to have a lot of fun talking about Alabama's 63-0 win over Western Kentucky. So let me hear you in the comments. You can let me know what you thought about the game or what you think about my analysis for the game right there in the comments section at Joe Gaither 6. Send me a comment, question, query, or complaint. We've got six different little takeaways that we want to talk about from the game. And so we will get into that today as Alabama officially is 1-0 and there is officially football to talk about. Oh my gosh. I cannot tell you how happy I am that we actually had a weekend full of football and I got 2 hours worth of film to look over and review real football. No more of this practice, individual period drills, which is great. Thank you so much, University of Alabama, for letting us be out at those practices, but you're not really seeing a whole lot. So very, very excited to see a whole lot this weekend. Before we get into our review and the breakdown of the game, we want to tell you about our friends at Purple Turtle Roofing. They're the number one most reliable residential roofing replacement company in Alabama and Mississippi. Whether it's addressing leaks, storm damage, or general wear and tear, Purple Turtle Roofing is going to be there to deliver exceptional roof repair for your property. Purple Turtle Roofing is the leading expert in local residential roofing solutions. They're specialized in providing unparalleled service and quality craftsmanship for all your roof replacement needs. Call Dustin Foley and his team today at 877-PT-ROOF-5. That's 877-787-6635. You call them, they will set up your free roof inspection and make sure that you are prepared for any and all of life's storms. We had a little bit of a storm this weekend on Saturday, and that was a lot of fun. Not really. So I'm parking, 255 or so, 245, getting ready to go into Bryant-Denny Stadium. We can pick up our credentials at 3, and you know, your boy wants to be there right there on time. And as soon as I get out of the car, boom, thunderstorm just dropped right on top of us. So that was a nice way to start our game day on Saturday. But you need to be prepared for your next storm. Make sure you call Dustin Foley and Purple Turtle Roofing today. You can visit them online if you want to just check them out online at roofturtle.com. So we get in there Saturday, and look, let's just take it blow by blow by blow, hit by hit. We get in there Saturday. We get our credential. All right, we get all set up. Obviously, the rain put a big damper on things for a minute, but it still was a very successful debut for Kalen DeBoer. The guys did their walk of champions just like normal. They get out onto the practice, get out onto Bryant-Denny Stadium and start warming up just like normal. Everything was basically as normal. The only difference, of course, was Nick Saban was not on the sidelines. He was in the press box, or he walked through our press box to his suite where he enjoyed the game, which was highly unusual to see Coach Saban walking through the press box at game time. But got the Kalen DeBoer era started with a big 63-0 win. And, of course, this next week it's going to be even more Nick Saban hoopla as they dedicate Saban Field at Bryant-Denny Stadium for the South Florida game. And Coach Kalen DeBoer talked about that just a little bit today. You can read about it on BamaCentral.com, the Alabama Crimson Tide home on SI. You can read about Coach Saban's call and really this weekend's festivities. Coach DeBoer saying, oh, we won't really be a part of that. We'll be in warm-ups and in pregame meal and finishing our meetings, but we're excited to have that festivity right there in that celebration in Bryant-Denny Stadium. Let's talk about the actual game, right? 63-0. We've been talking about this. What's the DeBoer era going to look like? You know, how's Alabama going to operate without Nick Saban, 8 months now? But now we have actual evidence and actual gameplay. And I don't know about how you felt on Saturday in Bryant-Denny Stadium, but in the press box, I'm sitting up there watching Alabama decimate Western Kentucky. And look, we can be honest with ourselves. Western Kentucky, an inferior opponent out of the Conference USA. Come on, Alabama. We can't go find an FBS opponent. All right, we've done that debate many, many times. And obviously, Alabama has a pretty big road game against Wisconsin. So cut them a little bit of break with the early opener against Western Kentucky. But the Hilltoppers were no match for Alabama. TJ Finley throws two interceptions to Keon Sab, and that offense never really got going. So looking back at last week's prediction, we did say that Alabama would cover the 31.5-point spread. Yeah, they did that, 63 points. But we also said that Alabama and Western Kentucky would hit the over at 59.5 points. And we said that because we thought Alabama would score in that mid-50s range, but Western Kentucky would get into the end zone as well. So I'll wear a little egg on my face as the Alabama defense looked a lot smoother than I anticipated. They looked a lot more aggressive than I anticipated, and they had very, very few busts, very, very few missed assignments. There were a couple of missed assignments throughout the night, but very few, and none of them were detrimental. TJ Finley was not able to parlay any of the defensive busts into big plays. I believe really the biggest play was about a 30, TJ Finley ended up with a big old run on a scramble. That was almost it for Western Kentucky. Now, what really stood out to me about the defense? The speed. Everyone was flying around the entire game, and the entire game serves as a point because, yes, obviously Alabama's emptying its bench in a normal blowout, but you played so many players from an Alabama defensive perspective and a lot of guys on offense as well, but on defense, so many guys got action and not just mop-up duty action. Alabama's up 42-0. You guys need to go get your reps. No. We saw Xavier Brown start. Okay, we saw Quay Russell start. Okay, we saw tons of guys get action. We saw, who else? Jayla Jonah Mbakwe. We saw Xavier Mincy. We saw Red Morgan. We saw Brayson Hubbard on the back end. We saw Justin Jefferson on the third scrim series. Quay Russell ends up starting at our wolf position, but Quandarius Robinson comes into the game. Keanu Cope got himself a little bit of run in the second half. You just played so many guys. We all knew we were anticipating Tim Smith and Tim Keenan. We knew that was going to be a big pair with Jaheim Otis sitting right behind him. But James Smith, number 23, James Smith out of Carver Montgomery. Both the Carver Montgomery guys getting onto the field and getting significant action. Quay Russell and James Smith, both former five stars out of Carver Montgomery, and both of them seeing really, really significant action in high leverage situations. We saw a lot of Damon Payne as well. It was just very impressive to me to see the Alabama defense utilize its depth, not because, okay, player A is hurt, so we're going to player B. No, it was more so we're using player A, B, and C because we want to dictate. We want to keep the pace high. We want to keep the intensity high. We want to keep the aggression and speed as high as possible. And really and truly, I was impressed with Kane Womack. I was impressed with Kane Womack in his, the 4-2-5 swarm defense. I don't want to say they swarmed around out there because, golly, Joe, be more creative. Find you a better word. But they were attacking like a pack of wild animals. They were rallying to the football all day long, all night long. And, of course, we knew some of the who's who that were already going to play, the starters. But pretty much anybody who was a backup got significant action as well. Action in high leverage situations where, okay, TJ Finley and them boys are driving down the field in the first half still on that, 15, 20 play drive, converting on fourth down two different times. You had Brayson Hubbard in at that point. You had Red Morgan in at that point. You had freshmen and inexperienced players playing in high level leverage situations. And you think back to the Coach Saban era, that wasn't always the case. Fellas didn't earn the trust as easily. and Coach Kane Womack talking today in the Naylor Stone media room about the weekend, saying, okay, we had a lot of guys that met the first benchmark for we trust you up to this point. And they said, now going into South Florida, that benchmark is going to be raised a little bit. We need to see even more consistency out of our young guys. You can't stay a young guy. You can't stay inconsistent. You can't continue to make little mistakes. Which there were a couple of little mistakes, but nothing detrimental. He says, we're going to raise the bar of accountability. We're going to raise the bar of trust. And so the guys are just going to keep improving. But from a selfish standpoint, from someone who thought, okay, Coach Saban, you're being a little bit old here. Looking at the transfer portal, looking at NIL, and looking at the way Alabama has recruited over 17, now 18 years. You're bringing in five-star after five-star after five-star. Get these young men on the field as early as possible. Let them make mistakes, especially in situations where you're playing Western Kentucky and you're not, you know, SEC championship game throwing guys in there who haven't played yet. I loved it. I thought Kalen DeBoer and the Kane Womack, I thought they combined together to say, okay, we've got this really deep team. We've got this really talented team. But I looked through the roster, and there's a lot of inexperience. What's the best way? Oh, just get them out there. Just throw them out there. Just throw them out there on the field. Live and die with the results. You had plays. I think it was on that fourth and on the drive where they converted two fourth downs where they got stopped on fourth and goal. From the five, you had on that drive, Red Morgan commits a pass interference. You had a couple guys, you know, miss on a coverage, but just so much rallying to the football and so much really just I thought that anytime there was a bust in the back, anytime that there was kind of an issue in the back end, the front seven, the front six really were getting after TJ Finley. And so from just a pure attitude standpoint, defensively, aggression, speed, I don't want to say that Coach Saban was running a bad scheme by any means. Obviously, his scheme yielded you six national championships and seven if you're an LSU Tiger, right? You've won a lot with the scheme, but it just was very clear to me from the press box that, oh, these guys aren't thinking, right? These guys aren't really having to sit there and think a whole lot. They're getting the call, and it's, oh, I'm, you know, deep safety in cover two, or, oh, I'm filling the hole right here. I'm filling whatever their case may be. It was, I'm getting the call, I have one job, and I'm executing that one job, and everybody else is on the same page. So I thought it was amazing. I thought it was a great first step defensively when you looked at South Alabama and you saw, okay, we walked into last week, we told you all about it. You gave up 44 points the last time you played Western Kentucky, Kane Womack. You gave up 52 points the last time you played TJ Finley. So there were signs to be had that Western Kentucky and TJ Finley could combine their experience against the Kane Womack 4-2-5 defense and not threaten Alabama to the fact that maybe they could win, but score a couple times. Keep the game interesting. And let's be honest, the game was never interesting. Never interesting. It was just interesting from an inside baseball perspective, from a let's look and see how good or bad this Alabama team is. On the third drive of the game, basically after Keon Sabb's second pick that got returned all the way to whatever, the 30-yard line or so, after his second pick, TJ Finley was gone. His mind was... He came back out a couple more times, right? But every single time he came back out to the field, it was a defeated quarterback. It was, I'm throwing this ball as quickly as I can. I'm not really working my way through the progressions. I'm just going to, okay, try to hit the first receiver that I see. And he was out of it mentally by that point. Now, Western Kentucky did make a quarterback change at halftime. But by that point, it was not really any coming back in this game. And I think that Alabama had found their confidence, had found it, especially defensively. And so it was just a lot of fun to see Alabama. Everything that we've heard for the last 6-8 months, oh, Alabama's defense is going to be faster. Alabama's defense is going to look at the quarterback more, have more eyes on the quarterback. Well, boom, what happens? Keon Sabb, two interceptions right off the bat. Deontay Lawson dropped himself a pick six. Let's just be honest with it. Deontay Lawson was dropping into hook zone coverage. A tight end or slot receiver is, you know, dropping right next to him. And he read TJ Finley all the way, stepped right in front of it. Would have been a pick six if he could have caught the ball. There's going to be a lot more opportunities for turnovers for this Alabama defense. And we hearing from Kane Womack today, he said, okay, this is an area that I thought we didn't do as good a job as we could have getting our hands on the football, whether it be in creating fumble situations or tipping the passes and, you know, creating interceptions as well. So if you get two interceptions and you could have had another easy, and your defensive coordinator is walking away saying, oh man, we could have had more turnovers. And that's the big message for the team going into this next week. I don't want to sit over here and be Homer Harry, but the excitement for what this team could be should be high, should be very high. Now, look, you didn't play Clemson like Georgia did. You didn't play USC or any, you know, Power Five quality opponent. But there was a lot of really, really fundamental things that this team was doing very well on Saturday defensively that can take them a long, long way. If you maintain the health, we heard Deshaun Jones, the reason Deshaun Jones didn't play right off the bat was a hamstring injury, and that led to more of the freshmen getting into the game from the cornerback position. Look, you just stay healthy and you continue to develop experience. I'm hoping that you see another 20, 25 guys playing on Saturday against South Florida. The South Florida tempo, the up, 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 we're snapping it every 6 seconds, every 7 seconds, right? I think they averaged snapping the football at like 23, 24 seconds on the clock last year, so that's 11 seconds per play, right? So that's really, really fast. No, they're going to snap it as quick as possible. They're going to try to get after you on Saturday. So, yeah, you want these bodies to be ready to go. You want to have another night on Saturday night where you're seeing 20 Alabama players get some significant action on defense. Why? Because in the fourth quarter, you want these guys to be healthy. If Justin Jefferson is going to play as well as he played on Saturday, then all my preseason concerns about Alabama's third inside linebacker and the health concerns for Deontay Lawson and Jihad Campbell go out the window, right? You think about everything that you saw on Saturday. You saw how many defensive backs got action. Let's count them, right? Xavier Brown, Damani Jackson, Jalen Mbakwe, Xavier Mincy, and even Deshaun Jones in his less than 100%. You had five corners that played. You played Malachi Moore and Keon Sabb. You played Devontae Smith at Husky. There you go, three. So we're up to eight. Yeah, Red Morgan brings you to nine. Bray Hubbard brings you to 10. You're playing 10 defensive backs in your first week. That's amazing. Just incredible. How many defensive backs were you playing last year? If it wasn't Terrion Arnold and Kuhad McKinstry, they weren't really getting a whole lot of run from the cornerback position last season. And so I am excited about what we saw, but it's still just a first step. And you still have to keep in mind that I think that Western Kentucky is going to have a decent year. But TJ Finley, that marriage is not going to work out. That marriage is going to – it's going to look good in games where Western Kentucky has the upper hand talent-wise. But if TJ Finley's mind is still – I don't want to say fragile because that sounds too harsh. But if his mind is still so malleable that, okay, you knew you were playing as a 31-point underdog. You just kind of have to embrace it if you're going to be successful, TJ Finley. Obviously, he had that quote before the game about how we're going to show Alabama who we are, that sort of thing. But you just got to embrace the hard. You can't be three series in, head down, terrible body language, just barely whipping the balls out, just barely throwing the passes, hardly reading down the field, not giving your offense a chance to develop. He totally threw in the towel, and so I think that's going to be a real challenge for Western Kentucky, for Tyson Helton to overcome the rest of the year. We looked through the Western Kentucky schedule just a little bit last week. I think they do have several, maybe another 8-win season on deck. And so it'll look like a fine win for Alabama, but talent-wise, just stacking them up, stacking up the Hilltoppers and the Crimson Tide, it was night and day. Defensively, TJ Finley did not threaten Alabama the way that I thought he was going to have a chance to down the field. Didn't really give a whole lot of things to develop. And obviously it was not really a dual threat athlete, much more of a pocket passer. So Alabama was able to get after him. What I was impressed with. Okay. All right. There's note number one. I want to talk about Quay Russo and Quandarius Robinson just a little bit. Let's move into that. Quay Russo starts at Wolf for Alabama, and we're not going to say that came out of nowhere, but all the indication during fall camp was that Quandarius Robinson was your starter. And we talked about it a little bit during fall camp and during the summer. Okay, can Quandarius Robinson step into Dallas Turner and step into Chris Braswell, Will Anderson's shoes? You've been here, fifth-year guy, graduate guy. It's time to take that step. Well, first snap on Saturday night in Bryant-Denny Stadium, it's Querusso playing the Wolf. And really, what you saw was pretty interesting to me. Querusso kind of not always staying to one side, but playing not technically to the depth of an inside linebacker, but more in between the inside linebacker depth and lineman depth. So it wasn't up on the line all night. He was much more right behind Tim Smith, Tim Keen, and Jaheim Otis, kind of floating, depending on whatever the schematics called for at the moment. But I loved it. And I thought, really, that Russo, this is not a pat me on the back. I hope that this was recorded at some point. But I did think that Russo was kind of the guy to, okay, he could be the star of the group right now, the most standout of the group right now. Well, Querusso came out. He played well. He played really well setting the edge and getting into pass coverage a little bit and holding his own defensively. But what we saw from Querusso, from Quandarius Robinson, on the first to third down of the game. Robinson gets subbed in. It's third and 12 or so. It's third and long or so. Russo comes off. Robinson comes in. And man, he rushed around the edge. His rush around the edge was violent. It was, it was a car crash coming around the edge, crashing into TJ Finley. And you got to give a lot of credit to Quandarius Robinson for doing that. And it made me think, okay, what are we really going to do with this position? What are we really doing here? Kane Womack still experimenting? Is he still deciding? Is he still trying to work out what he has in this Wolf room? You saw later on in the game, you ended up seeing James Smith on the inside with, was it James Smith and Damon Payne, I think it was, on the inside. And on the outside, you ended up, it was a passing down. On the outside, it was Jihad Campbell has moved from his stinger position to one of these edge rushers. And then, boom, you had Robinson. And so you had four just really athletic pass rushers up front. I think that Kane Womack is going to have just a real blast this year utilizing personnel to really mess with these offenses, really bleep with these offensive coordinators and these quarterbacks with not knowing where the heat is going to be coming from, whether it's, oh, it's coming right up the middle from Deontay Lawson. Oh, we're moving Campbell from the middle to the outside. Oh, all right, I've been watching four on the outside. Now we got to watch, what is he, 34 for Quandarius Robinson. I thought that while you didn't see a ton of Quandarius Robinson outside of that one sack, I think you saw what you wanted to see a little. I mean, at least for a first week, and we're going to get into bigger and more important opponents and more challenging games. But for a first week, you saw, okay, when called upon, when it tapped to go rush the passer, he flew. Quandarius Robinson flew around the edge, and he tattooed TJ Finley. I'm very impressed that TJ Finley was able to hold on to that football. And I just want to give a little shout out because, I was concerned about Robinson's ability to replace Deontay Lawson and to replace Dallas Turner and to replace Will Anderson and Chris Braswell. And it seems like you have a room of wolves right now ready to do that. I'm really excited to see how they utilize Querusso the rest of the year. Seems like he's going to be kind of this, not really an inside linebacker, kind of an edge rusher, kind of an outside linebacker, kind of a Mr. Everything. And so I'm excited to see how sophomore Querusso develops. All right, so we hit 63-0. We hit how many people played on defense. We hit Querusso. We hit Quandarius Robinson. How about, all right, let's look at, the rest of my notes look like they're offensive notes. So before we go into offensive notes, we should tell you about my friend Derek Daniel at State Farm. Derek Daniel, you can call him today at 205-758-3391 for all of your insurance needs. We really appreciate Derek Daniel for sponsoring the program, and you should give him a call today and give him a chance to earn your business. Great local agent right here in Tuscaloosa, born in Tuscaloosa, I believe went to Brookwood. So he is born and bred in Tuscaloosa. He knows West Alabama like the back of his hand. Call him. 205-758-3391. You need an auto insurance quote. You're buying a car, you're selling a car, we're trading a car. They can get you a quick quote Red, Reese, and Victoria are waiting to take your call right now and get you on and off the phone, give you the information that you need to make a decision about your insurance. And in this town, in Tuscaloosa, we love Tuscaloosa, but you need to be properly covered, especially from an auto insurance standpoint. So call Derek Daniel and his team today at 205-758-3391. Like a good neighbor, Derek Daniel and State Farm is there. Oh, as my dog gets into the trash below me, let's move it on. Let's move on to Alabama's offense just a little bit. I got notes on Jalen Milroe. I got notes on Parker Brailsford. I got notes on Elijah Pritchett. And, of course, the Alabama running back. So what do we want to start with? As always, you can jump in on the comments at the Joe Gaither 6 on Facebook, Twitter, or YouTube and let me know what you thought about the game, just like Everett Osmer did on Facebook a little bit ago. Let's talk about Jalen Milroe. Jalen, all right, how many quarterbacks in Alabama history have thrown for 3 touchdowns and run for 2 touchdowns in the same game? I believe I saw over the weekend that none other than Jalen Milroe, and Jalen Milroe, I think he's done it 3 different times. 79 yards on 10 carries, 2 tutties. He was 7 for 9, 200 yards, and 3 touchdowns through the air. How do you think Jalen Milroe played? Are you happy with his progression? Did you see progression? Or do you think that, you know, there's still question marks around last year's 6th place Heisman Trophy finisher? Jalen Milroe to me looked better in a lot of ways. 2 major plays stood out to me. First, the first touchdown pass to Kendrick Law, and really the touchdown pass to Ryan Williams, the first touchdown pass. Both touchdown passes to Ryan Williams showed pretty nice growth for Jalen Milroe, but I want to focus on the first play with Kendrick Law, the first touchdown play with Kendrick Law, and the first touchdown, the 84, 85-yarder to Ryan Williams. Let's start with the first one, Kendrick Law. What a beautiful play. What a beautiful play, right? You are dropping back. It's 3rd and change, right? Let's see what drive was that on, Joe? Because I've got all these clips clipped up right here, and maybe we can put it into the stream and let people actually see what we're talking about, Joe. That would be smart, right? Western Kentucky work videos. I think it was about the your drive. Yeah, I think it's this drive, right? Yeah, perfect. Oh, that's his first touchdown run. All right, he's taking quarterback power, quarterback sweep off the side. Let's think about it. Let's see if I can't find a video file. It's the next one. Yeah. Keon Sabs already returned his next interception, and here we go. 3rd and 6 for Alabama. Jalen Milroe drops back, and he gets rushed a little bit, steps up through the pocket, and as he steps up through the pocket, he definitely can get this first down. He can slip through and get – you have seen Jalen's explosion for a year and almost – a year and a game now, right? Almost 3 years, dating back to his time backing up Bryce Young. He can go ahead and get this first down. He can either get the first down by running around to the outside, or he can just run up the middle. And very likely he's going to set Alabama – if he does that, he'll set Alabama up 1st and goal from the 10. 1st and goal from the 9, right? He might even have 1st and 10 from the 13. But no, Jalen Milroe keeps his eyes up, right? He keeps his eyes. He knows that Kendrick Law has run this kind of drag route from the right side to the left side. He and C.J. Dupree actually run into each other. That's something they're going to have to work out, the depth on this route. But they kind of run into each other on the 2 underneath crossers. Okay, well, that's not that big of a deal. Jalen's obviously looking to the top. He's looking at Jeremy Bernard. Jeremy Bernard's pretty well covered. So he steps up. He's like, okay, we got to get this 3rd down. We got to stay on the field. He steps up, and before he can get to the line of scrimmage, he pops his eyes back up and looks directly at Kendrick Law. Directly at Kendrick Law, who's standing there wide open at the 1st down marker. Okay, what does he do? He rips a pass that hits hits Kendrick Law right at the top of the 1 where his sternum, right where your buttons are on your polo. Right there, bullet pass, of course, Joe, it's not more than a 12-ish yard pass considering the width, right? The width of the field. But it's not that long of a pass. But it is a dot right to Kendrick Law. And why is this important? Well, one, he's already got the first down with the reception. But two, the accuracy of the pass lets Kendrick Law get it going. And boom, he scores for Alabama. Run after the catch. Now, what does this show? What are we noticing here? What are we picking up here? We're picking up two things. We're picking up one, Jalen Milroe scrambling to throw and not scrambling to run, different from last year. And two, the accuracy on the ball that he delivers to Kendrick Law. Those two factors give you a touchdown. And granted, okay, could Jalen Milroe have run this ball and set Alabama up first down? Right, we just ran over that. He absolutely could have. And would Alabama more than likely have scored a touchdown on the drive? Yeah, more than likely. We have seen by now a couple drives into the game, the sixth drive of the game, that Alabama is out physically matching Western Kentucky. They would have likely scored on the drive anyways. But impressive to me, we're seeing, okay, an athlete who knows he's a super athlete, who knows he's the best athlete on the field, knowing that, okay, I could run this ball and take this hit, and yeah, Alabama would likely get a first down. But the smarter, the better, the more efficient play, it's gorgeous. It's gorgeous. Stepping up, eyes up, oh, Kendrick Law, 12 yards away, wide open in the flat, bam, deliver right on the dot. And let's let him, the athlete, the one that's making all the money to catch the balls and run into the end zone, let's let him do the dirty work and risk his body, per se. All right? I loved it. I thought Kendrick Law, I thought it was a wonderful, wonderful play. I was really, really impressed with Jalen for the execution of that play. Let me see if I can't pull up this Ryan Williams play, because while it looks like it's a play all for Ryan Williams, it's really not. Here we go. I think we're looking right. Yeah. Is this it right here? Right. All right. Perfect. At three and change. We go out of bounds. Oh, yeah, it's a weird drive, right? It's a weird drive. You end up with third and 14 because you have screw-ups to work out offensively, and that's going to be one of my points here. I guess we'll get into that after. But it's third and 14. You got duo to the bottom. You basically have a trips formation, and what you have is – seven, Cole Adams in the very most slot is running kind of an over route. You've got Jeremy Bernard in the slot, in the traditional slot, running a post, and Ryan Williams running a go. Just a straight-up go ball. If you've played Madden, if you've played NCAA, you've run this play all the time. It's called PA Crossers. You run it all the time. And it's one of the most basic plays in football. But what is so impressive here is the way that Jalen reads the play. Sure, the pass is great, and we're all excited for Ryan Williams, but it's the way that Jalen reads the play, and it's Nick Sheridan's genius. Nick Sheridan and Kalen DeBoer's genius. All right, we're watching it full on from right here, and bam, Ryan Williams catches the ball and runs at 85 yards, and everybody's losing their mind. The kid is 17 years old. He shouldn't be on a college field. But here we can see the route a little bit better, and we can see what Jalen Milroe actually does. Milroe is staring the safety dead in the face, because that's who we're reading. We're reading this deep right safety, and he's thinking to himself, as you're looking at the coverage, this bad boy looks like some version of cover two. You've got two safeties playing deep halves. You've got this middle linebacker dropping deep into a hole, and both these corners look like they're kind of sitting into a flatter coverage, except for the corner who's seeing Ryan Williams go past him. This corner knows that there's no one behind him. This corner knows that his safety is about to be into some major conflict. We're about to have a real problem on our hands in the Western Kentucky defensive backfield, right? He knows, I've got the flats. I'm going to play my responsibility. He actually carries Ryan Williams further than he really should have. But he's pointing. There he goes. Number two is flying. Basically, the safety has a choice. Do I follow Jeremy Bernard over the middle and try to close that down? Or am I going to shift out and follow Ryan Williams and keep that covered? You've got a choice, and he's wrong no matter what he does. We see the safety kind of close a little bit, choosing to stay with Jeremy Bernard. If Jalen wanted to be a bad mother bleeper, you can still probably, you can see it in the screenshot right here, but you can still probably find Jeremy Bernard over the top here. He's still probably open, but not near as open as what's happening with Ryan Williams. And so it's very impressive to me to see Milroe go from 1 to 2 to 3. Really, I think that Jeremy Bernard is 1. So 1 to 2. I think that Bernard is 1. Ryan is 2. He is wearing jersey number 2, but he's a 2 on this play with Cole Adams, the 3. And then you see, I think it's Josh Quavos running the crossing pattern from the other side, giving him kind of a bailout. But the point is that Ryan is not your number 1 receiver here. This play is not drawn up for a Ryan Williams touchdown. What it is drawn up for is a touchdown. It is drawn up to score a touchdown because very clearly we heard from Kalen DeBoer, we heard from Nick Sheridan that they thought that there would be an opportunity to have a receiver flying down the sidelines. So very clearly they know, okay, this passing pattern, this post fly, this go ball with a post on the inside, you're putting that deep safety into a massive conflict. And so, boom, Jalen sees it, he delivers it, the ball is on time. Sure, could it be another 3 yards in front of him? Probably, could be. But when the receiver's that wide open, when it's that wide open, there's a little bit of a, oh, I better hit this pass from Jalen Milroe. And that's exactly what he does. I'm very impressed with Jalen Milroe's progression already through this early part of the season. You can see signs of growth, and you can see signs of really understanding how the offense actually works, how the manipulation of your eyes affects the defense, and how everyone on defense responds to what you do. And so you can really start to manipulate the defense. And if Jalen Milroe is going to learn that over the course of this year, look, again, I don't want to be Homer Harry, but he's the best athlete playing quarterback in the country. We heard Malachi Moore talking about how fast he is. We have seen the efficient deep ball. We have seen the deep ball be effective over a year and change. If you also ramp up his level of understanding, which was a problem last year, let's just be honest with ourselves, with each other. His level of understanding of offense and of defense was a problem last season and was one of the primary reasons that Seth McLaughlin stayed in the lineup the entire season. But if you improve that area, the understanding, the way the offense actually works, how to go from 1 to 2 to 3, who am I reading and what, and trusting your reads as well. Look, I can sit here and explain it to you, but if you put me under center, there ain't no way my body would trust the reads. I'm crumbling under the pass rush, right? And you are too. Let's be honest with it. You are too. What you do on Madden and what you do on NCAA doesn't count. He's seeing live action coming at him. He's having to make live decisions, and he showed on Saturday a pretty nice little step forward. Are there things to work for him? Yes, 1,000%. You still got blindside rushed. You still got blindside rushed and ended up fumbling the ball away. Obviously, Elijah Pritchett, that's an issue that we can talk about. But Elijah Pritchett starts at left tackle, emergency start at left tackle, and gets speed rushed in the first half. And boom, Jalen Milroe, careless with the football, gets sacked and fumbles. Alabama recovers, but that's an area you need to work on, Jalen. That's an area that this is something very tangible that you can improve on. We also saw a snapping issue rear its ugly head. Oh, boy, you go out and get the best center in the country, and he snaps the ball over Jalen Milroe's head. Obviously, didn't result in any points, but he snaps the ball over Jalen Milroe's head, and how many of your PTSD was triggered, right? Oh, gosh. Snaps the ball over Jalen Milroe's head, and a little bit of confusion on what actually happened there, whether it's a cadence issue or whether it's a play clock issue or whether Jalen Milroe was trying to squeeze too many adjustments in. I think that Parker Brailsford looked up and saw 2-1 on the play clock and just snapped it. Because all 5 offensive linemen fired off the ball at the same time. They were all ready for the snap. We heard last year that some of the snapping issues was due to Jalen Milroe's inconsistent cadence and Jalen Milroe's inconsistent placement in the play, whether he was at 2 yards depth or 5 yards depth. And that does change some things. So just a small sign of things to continue to work on with the quarterback center exchange. But I was just so impressed with Jalen Milroe and his growth. Look, it's going to be slow. When you have players who are really, really working on their game, the growth is slow. But Jalen Milroe is still the best athlete playing quarterback in college football and showing lots of growth already in the Kalen DeBoer, Nick Sheridan scheme. Here we go. I've got three more notes, and I want to stay on the offense and just talk about the fact that you still have so much to work on offensively. You scored 63 points. Every single one of these points is valuable, right? Every single scoring summary, that's what I want. 12-yard touchdown run, 22-yard pass, 84-yard pass, 39-yard run, 85-yard run, 55-yard pass, 21-yard run, 2-yard run, and then 15-yard run. But most of these plays are big plays. You had, what, two over 80 yards already? Justice Haynes and Ryan Williams? Three over 50. So you're hitting big plays. Four over 35 yards. You're hitting big plays. And so a lot like last year where the offense wasn't very consistent, but Jalen Milroe would pull rabbits and magic out of his hat. There was a semblance of that. A little semblance of that. But what you saw on Saturday was a coaching staff that says, oh, I've got a lot more go-to plays. I've got a lot more gotcha plays. And, of course, Western Kentucky plays a little bit of factor in that, and their quality or lack thereof plays into that as well. But I think this coaching staff has a lot more answers and a lot more creativity. I'm sorry to Tommy Rees and Nick Saban last year, but I think this coaching staff has a lot more has a bigger arsenal of ways to put its players into good positions. You look at the 85-yarder by Justice Haynes, and it is just a gorgeous, oh my gosh, it is sex on TV. Looking at the offensive lineman, Elijah Pritchett, Tyler Booker, washing down the left side, and you got Jaden Roberts and Wilkin Formby, too. Of the biggest boys you can see just barreling around, pulling around, and it is choo-choo train, get out of the way. And Justice Haynes does the rest of the work. It was beautiful football. So you've got a lot of answers in this Alabama offense, but there are inconsistencies to overcome. The snapping issue we just talked about, the pass protection issue that you had with Elijah Pritchett making an emergency start. You had Jalen Milroe end up kind of on a bind when the offensive line was receiving five but didn't block five. They blocked four, right? You still have a little of these communication issues. You're still going to have communication issues with your wide receivers as you continue to develop chemistry with these wide receivers. On the Elijah Pritchett rush, right? On the Elijah Pritchett sack allowed, I think Jalen Milroe was looking to get the ball out, but the pressure moved him off the spot and the play was junked up. Yeah, there's definitely some things to work on. I think that this Alabama offense has a lot more room to grow in the consistency department. But you should be encouraged that the big plays came easily on Saturday. I want to go to one of the questions right here from today's media availability with Kalen DeBoer and just kind of get into it about Alabama and its big play offense.
The long ball with Ryan Williams, two catches, two touchdowns. Obviously, you want to see that. Do you ever worry about a home run ball and when stuff gets hard in the past, maybe stuff gets hard and you can't make those short passes because you rely on the home run ball? What's your thought on that as the season progresses?
Yeah, no, I mean, that's just part of the progression. You know, the progression took Jalen to Ryan. That's not the beginning of the progression on the first touchdown, and in particular, well, both of them. It was a later part of the progression, you know, and that says a lot about a lot of things. It says that the line did a good job protecting and giving him time with our tailback, and then in both of those routes, concepts, Jalen really working through the read and working to the very end. It might not have been the very last on one of them, but it's again, says a lot, you know, just thinking about Jalen and getting to Ryan, especially on the second touchdown. You know, that's coming across the middle, putting it where it needed to be. Confidence, you know, as a receiver when you're running across the middle like that, that your quarterback's, you know, not going to put you in a bad spot. So Ryan can just focus on the football and, you know, then breaking tackles too, two guys right there. So I don't feel like we rely on the long ball. I don't feel like that's what our offense is about. I feel like it's a progression, but there are usually big play opportunities that are built within almost, you know, really most of the concepts that we have, you know, and situational stuff too. You know, you're trying to move the sticks and you only need a few yards. Maybe there's not as many balls that are going to go down the field. That's just situational awareness for our quarterback and also our play caller. But we want that. We want that threat. We want the defensive coordinator, the defensive side of the ball that we're facing, to always be fearful of someone could get down the field behind them. And that helps us stretch both horizontally and vertically the coverage that we're seeing.
All right, so you may or may not have heard the question right there, but basically they're asked, Caleb DeBoer is asked, are you worried about the offense relying on big plays too much? And I'm sorry. We are one game into this. We are one game into the Caleb DeBoer era. We have played one game of football against an inferior opponent. And of course, you would have liked to have seen more consistent offense, right? There are definitely areas that can be cleaned up. A couple blocking assignments need to get ironed out. You had a false start. You had a couple of holding penalties. But basically every time the Alabama offense called a running play, it was just – it was, you know, get out the way, honey. Alabama's coming down the field, right? Every time, right? You get that 85-yard running play, you know what they were trying to do? They're just trying to milk some of the clock out and then get a scored in the half. What are you going to do? Tell Justice Haynes, hey, man, if you are breaking through the defense, and no one's there to tackle you and you're running faster than everyone else, we just want you to go down at the 40-yard line. You know, we want to work on consistent offense. We just want you to go down at the 25-yard line. We got to work on the red zone a little bit. No. How dumb is this? The object of the game is to score. The object of the game is to score touchdowns, score more points than the other team, get across the white line at the end of the field. And what are you gonna? We're doing that too fast. What are we doing here? And I understand that. Okay, you got to look at a 63-0 game and nitpick. You got to look at a 63-0 game and say, what can we work on? And you got to look at a 63-0 game and blame the opponent's inferiority. Look, in 2 weeks, I know Wisconsin struggled in their opener, but in 2 weeks, Wisconsin's going to be better than Western Kentucky. And in, 4 weeks now, Georgia is definitely going to be better than Western Kentucky. So, yes, there are improvements to be made. There are absolutely improvements to be made. But is one of our complaints going to be that Alabama is scoring too many touchdowns? Alabama is scoring, having too many big plays? I mean, look at the play we just outlined, the Ryan Williams touchdown. And Coach Caleb DeBoer highlighted it right there. The play is, it's 3rd and 14. You got to get a first down to keep the clock going, keep the drive going, keep the offense on the field. So what do? Let's go to our 3rd and 14 plays. And here's a concept that we think is going to work. It's little PA crossers. There was no play action, but basically this crossers pattern, right? You get the drag, you get the post, you get the fly. We're going to manipulate a safety. We're going to try to get a first down. We're either going to be squeezing one into the post or we're going over the top to the long ball. And the safety dictated that. And safety said, oh, you know what? I'm going to stick closer to the post and leave the child all alone. And what? Jalen Milroe is supposed to be like, well, you know, I know that Ryan Williams is open. I know that this is the design of the play. This is the way it's schemed up. But I'm just, you know, he's probably going to score 85-yard touchdown, and we need to work on, you know, our offensive consistency. No. You take the plays that are there to be made. What was Jalen Milroe supposed to do on the first touchdown pass? Just not throw it out to Kendrick Law because, oh, he might score? Just an absurd line of thinking. there are things to get better on. There is consistency to be found offensively. The offense was fun on Saturday, 63 points, a lot of fun. But under the hood, there's a couple things to work on for sure. One of them is not less big play touchdowns. You got open field in front of you. You got green grass in front of you. It is all gas, no brakes, get to the end zone. And I think that really what we saw on Saturday was this coaching staff's ability to put the players in positions to succeed. They said, oh, we got good players. We just need to dial up the right plays. We think if we call this crossers concept that the safety is going to be – we think they're going to be in cover two, and that safety is going to be wrong no matter what. And so – was it, hey, let's dial up a play for Ryan Williams, or hey, let's dial up a play for Jeremy Bernard? No, it wasn't. It was, let's dial up a good play to get a first down. And if the other team just, if the magic happens where it's a perfect play against a perfect play call, right? They called cover two. That was exactly what Kalen DeBoer and Nick Sheridan wanted. They wanted the cover two look so that they could put the safety in conflict. And are you worried that you are just seeing the football field too well, that you're just dialing up too many perfect plays? No. And plus, we're one game into this. Who's to say what's going to happen this coming week? Now look, we can say what we think will happen. I think Alabama's going to score another bunches of points against South Florida. But Western Kentucky might end up being really horrible. And Saturday's performance might end up not being so good. Might end up not looking as good. And so why are we doing this? Are you worried, coach, that things are working out too well? It's absolutely absurd. Last thing for us right here on the Joe Gaither Show on Monday, breaking down Western Kentucky, Alabama over Western Kentucky, 63-0. Last thing for us is Ryan Williams and Keon Sabb. Keon Sabb being named SEC's co-defensive player of the week, and Ryan Williams being named co-freshman of the week. Ryan Williams sharing that honor with Nico Iamaleava. There we go. We're getting that name down. Iamaleava, the Tennessee quarterback, had a really good game, and good on him. But he's not 17, and he didn't have just two receptions for just two touchdowns and just 139 yards. Ryan Williams duly earned SEC Freshman of the Week. And Keon Sapp, obviously, with the two interceptions, had to be on the short list for SEC Defender of the Week. And just made me think about the two guys that Alabama lost in the transfer portal, two of the biggest names, Isaiah Bond and Caleb Downs. Look, would you love to have Isaiah Bond and Caleb Downs on this football team? Yes, you absolutely would. I'm not going to sit here and give you the propaganda that you don't want them anymore. They're two good players, two real good players, two real, real, real good players. But all you did was say, okay, we can't pay you Caleb Downs what you want, and no Nick Saban here to keep you. Okay, Isaiah Bond, we definitely can't pay you what you wanted. All right, y'all go to the transfer portal, have a great career, enjoy your time at Ohio State and Texas. Alabama just pivoted and said, we're going to go out and get a good safety. We're going to go out and get a really quality player in Keon Sabb. And, oh, we're going to go find a generational prospect from the wide receiver position. I think Alabama upgraded, not necessarily the safety position. I think that's absurd. Caleb Downs is that good of a player. But Keon Sapp's a hell of a player as well. Did they downgrade? No. The change is negligible. Now, offensively speaking, we talked about it a lot, about how Alabama hasn't had a true wide receiver one since the John Metchie, Jameson Williams year, 2021. You went 2 years without a wide receiver one. Jermaine Burton, Isaiah Bond. Sorry, guys. Y'all aren't wide receiver ones. They're good players. You're good players. But Alabama upgraded in the wide receiver department. So it was a good first week. It was a real good first week. We digest the first week and we say, okay, this team has a lot of room to improve, but this team has a lot to love. A lot to love playing all the experience, playing all the players that you got to play on Saturday defensively and offensively. You saw Ty Simpson get in there. You saw all scholarship running backs, Kevin Riley and Daniel Hill, joining Richard Young, Jam Miller, and Justice Haynes. So all five scholarship running backs got carries. Great game. Cole Adams looks like he might be a little water bug, dangerous punt returner. Great game. Played so many players. Got to stay consistent this week. We'll hear from select players tomorrow on the Bama Central YouTube channel, and we will hear from select coordinator players. Excuse me, we already heard from the coordinators today. players tomorrow and assistant coaches on Wednesday. And then we'll have Hey Coach again on Wednesday night and get ready for the South Florida game. It's going to be a big Saturday. The Saban Field dedication, it will be on Saturday. So a lot of our coverage this week will be on the Saban Field. Look, I'll just be honest with you. I think Remember Me Radio or Remember When Radio is horrible. It's just not my style, just not my flavor. But we will be doing a little bit of that this week as we remember a lot of great memories on Saban Field at Bryant Denny Stadium. It's going to be a big week, and we'll see if the Crimson Tide can stay consistent, can build off a strong performance from this past week in 63-0 over Western Kentucky. That's going to do it for the Joe Gaither Show right here on Bama Central and BamaCentral.com. You watch us on the Bama Central YouTube channel. You listen to us on the Joe Gaither Show on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or on Amazon. We appreciate our sponsors, Derek Daniels State Farm, Purple Turtle Roofing, and Druid City Music Hall. You can check out Druid City Music Hall right now at druidcitymusichall.com/shows. They've got another Thursday, Friday set this week. It's going to be Charlotte Sam and Taylor Acorn on Thursday, and it's going to be Zach Hood on Friday as we want to get you ready for the weekend. Look, Druid City Music Hall, the premier place for live music on the Strip. You want to feel like you're partying back in your college days, Druid City Music Hall is a great venue to do it because clean, a little bit away from the students, about a block away, right, from Rounders and 1225. Clean bathrooms, big bars, great music venue to watch some up-and-coming artists. So we appreciate Druid City Music Hall for being a part of the program. We'll get out of here for the day. We're going to try to catch up with some folks from South Florida through the week to get ready for the Bulls. But it's going to be a fun week. Game week number two right here on the Joe Gaither Show on Bama Central and BamaCentral.com.
Thanks for joining us on today's edition of the Joe Gaither Show on Bama Central. Keep up with Joe on all his social media pages at JoeGaither6. Subscribe, rate, and review the show on Spotify and Apple Podcasts, and be sure to read us daily at BamaCentral.com.